Welcome to How Good is Politics, where we discuss, dissect and analyse the week that was in federal politics. I'm Kerrie Yaxley and joining me this week is Nine's Chris O'Keefe and Phil Coorey, the political editor of the Australian Financial Review. The Morrison government is back down to business after its unexpected victory on May 18. We saw the ministry sworn in this week. I was somewhat surprised to see a few faces in there. For example, Michaela Cash. I didn't think she'd make it after the AWU fiasco,
harsh.
Back in, I know, harsh, back in cabinet. Phil, any surprises for you?
No. I mean, he didn't have a lot to work with, did he? I mean, I mean that in a charitable sense. I mean, remember before the election, three or four cabinet ministers resigned.
Yes.
And they're already their batting order is already fairly thin before that on their benches. So, as I said on another show, it looked like a mouthful of missing teeth through their front bench. So he didn't really have a lot to, he had a lot of gaps to fill and not a lot to fill it with. So I think he did a pretty good job in the circumstances in terms of the people he brought forward, but always conscious of the women thing.
Yeah.
I mean, he said before the election, the Prime Minister, that I'm going to have the same amount at a minimum. So you couldn't punt any of the women, because there was no one else to put up, basically.
Yeah.
So, Cash, survived probably because she's female.
Yeah.
Melissa Price, I mean, they kept her in the outer ministry. It's not just, it's like the same for blokes, Kerrie. It's not all about merit. A lot of dunderplunkins in there who are men as well. So you should have dunderplunkins who are women as well.
It was too surprised. I think Stuart Robert was a bit of surprise that he made his return.
Yeah.
So pays to be friends with the Prime Minister, pays to be friends with the boss.
He's
I
a
suppose.
Good mate of the PMs. They're very close. I mean, Morrison brought him back into the junior ministry after the coup, and I think it was, he was on the fast track.
Was he? $2,000 a month he was spending on his home internet. He was scandal prone, and next thing you know, he's back into the ministry. And I think Tim Wilson as well. I thought, I was surprised he didn't get elevated to at least the outer ministry, given, essentially he was the mastermind behind the retiree tax attack, which worked very well for them. And to see him not rewarded, I was a bit surprised at that.
Yeah,
so
Susan
he.
Lee.
Yeah, so was he.
Yeah, Susan Lee back as well.
Yeah,
she's
another one.
Done her
wilderness.
Time.
Yes.
Yeah. What about Ken Wyatt, the first Indigenous Affairs Minister? That was a significant moment for the nation.
Yeah, it was good. And he's a thoughtful fellow, Ken. And I think, though, that the celebration will soon turn to expectation.
Mm.
He'll have to... I heard him do an interview this morning where we're speaking, and he's really across the whole thing of Indigenous disadvantage and the whole, the scope of the task ahead of him and so forth, and also this constitutional recognition thing, which Labor's keen to get on with, and everyone else is, apart from the Conservatives in the coalition. So he'll have a lot. That'll soon turn to expectation on Ken, and your star can fall pretty fast, whether he's Indigenous or not, if he doesn't deliver.
And the Nationals are a little bit grumpy, Chris, that they didn't get everything they wanted.
Surprise!
Yeah, there's always you can't please everyone.
just a little bit.
But interestingly, they held marginal seats in Queensland they weren't expected to hold. Mm. They did much better than everyone expected. George Christensen, Ken O'Dowd. They did really, really well. And I suppose what was interesting too was the split with Bridget McKenzie and David Littleproud, with Bridget McKenzie taking agriculture.
Yeah.
I don't know how happy Littleproud
was. Well,
that was
pretty miserable. See, what happened, they got four members in the cabinet, and Bridget McKenzie sort of had a make-work portfolio. It was sort of like, wheelbarrows and paperclips and black spots or something like that. Some really crappy job. So they argued quite rightfully that... we did well in the election. We're the only coalition party got a swing to us, so we want a serious job for Bridget.
Yeah.
So rather than pinching it off a Liberal and giving her something, it was like they made David Littleproud share his Easter eggs with his sister. She got half of his job, and he got left with slops. And what she got had been diluted anyhow, because agriculture's been, so there's water. One of the Liberals has got water, and someone else has got. Bridget will basically be just going to field days and going, So they felt a little bit underdone, quite rightfully, I think.
Yeah.
And that reflected back on the leader, Michael McCormack, who some feel didn't really sort of drive hard enough a bargain on behalf of his peeps.
Now, do you think Barnaby will be lurking in the background still? Do you think he'll have a powder dry?
He's never stopped lurking, has he? But he's in a world of pain at the moment because he's just not under consideration. I mean, they don't have a spot for him in either the outer ministry or the cabinet. clearly he believes he should be right back in there. So I think just TBA on that one. Watch this space.
But realistically too, they did really well. So after the results that we saw on election night, how can Barnaby possibly think that he's going to, you know, get his way back into to cabinet, let alone become the leader again?
Yeah, I suspect he was sneakily hoping for him to lose a seat or two so he could... That's my suspicion, but it didn't happen.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what happens in that space going forward. Okay, let's talk about Labor. They're settling on their leadership team in front bench. Phil, can you explain for the many, many people, I'm sure, who do not understand what goes on behind the scenes here, how the factions decide on who gets what?
So you've got 30 members of your shadow ministry, 20 shadow cabinet, 20 outer ministry, and that matches what the government has. So what the system is in Labor is the factions pick those 30, and it's proportional. So the right, there's more people who belong to the right than the left, so the right gets to pick 16 of those spots and the left gets to pick 14. And then the leader, Anthony Albanese, once he's presented with this is your new front bench, he then gives them jobs. He gives them the portfolios. You're the shadow treasurer, you're the, you know, shadow trade minister, health, etc. That's how it works in a pure sense. It's always a bit murkier than that because the factions sort of, you know, negotiate deals about if we put him in, we want him to be treasurer and stuff. So the leader has to be mindful of all that. But that's the process we're going through at the moment. So the caucus meets, they'll elect the 30 members, and then the leader will then sit down over the next couple of days and assign them all jobs.
So when Anthony Albanese says there has been no deals, it's the biggest load of rubbish you've ever heard in your life.
Lol.
Ed Husick's clearly been offered something.
Yeah, I wonder what.
I mean, factionalism actually, you know, it gets bagged a lot, but by and large, it works really well. It's a very good mechanism for resolving disputes, for sharing the spoils and stuff like that. You know, so yeah, it keeps the personality out of it, and it worked. But it's got a really big downside because each faction has a quota. So of that right faction, you know, the 16 members, the New South Wales right gets to pick, you know, four or five or whatever, and there wasn't room for both Ed Husick and Christina Keneally. Now, in an ideal world, both of them should be on the front bench. Yeah. So, you know, and you've got Percy Peckerhead from the Galagambone left who gets, he gets a spot, you know, whereas he should be given the flick and it should be, you know, so, you know, I mean, and it's not, you know, you've got to take into account factionalism, gender and states, just like the Liberal Party does, they just don't formalise it. So you always get dunderheads who get ahead of good people and that's the way it is, but it keeps the peace.
And at least... on appearance level needs to strike the balance between experienced and giving fresh blood a chance. Do you think that we'll see Anthony Albanese deliver on that?
I don't think so. I don't think there's any fresh blood in the Labor front bench at all.
Well, they're all still fresh.
Tell me how Bill Shorten's fresh blood. Yeah. Like, do you think he's going to sit there and behave himself for the next 3 years? That's very unlikely. So for Anthony Albanese to sit there and say, well, my front bench is better than theirs, I think that's absolute garbage.
Yeah, I slightly disagree because they were sort of cherry ripe to go into government. I mean, this is most of that front. They're all still in their late 40s, early 50s. They're not old.
No.
And most of them had ministerial experience in that last train wreck of a Labor government, and they'd sort of learned from that. And so they were ready to go. They were right. You know.
They lost.
I know. But the point is, they're not old or over the hill as such. So, and none of them want to retire.
You see, but you've got people on the backbench and within the Labor, you know, the Labor Party as a whole, not just in Parliament, who are saying Clare, Burke, Bowen.
Yeah, I think
they've all had a bite at the cherry. So, how many times do you give them a bite
but you don't chuck the whole team out. I mean, I agree, there's probably half a dozen, and I'm not naming names, but there's probably half a dozen you could sort of shuffle off or push aside. I think you should have been bringing up Ed Husick, Clare O'Neill from the junior ministry, people. They've got some good young people, but there's still a pretty good show. I mean, one of the things that's creeping into politics is this disdain for experience.
Right.
And I think one of the problems of the last 10 years is people are in too much of a hurry in this joint, and there's not enough premium is put on experience. And, you know, there used to be a thing called the 20-year rule. Unless you've been here 15 or 20 years, you shouldn't even contemplate being leader.
Right.
And now you've been here 20 years and you should be out the door, and, you know, Fred Nurk, who's been here 5 minutes, should be leader. I think you need to suffer defeat. I think you need to suffer hardship and defeat, and this will be good for Labor in the end. You know, it'll
come out,
they won't be
party.
So bloody cocky next time, maybe, and they might have learned a thing or two. Don't take money off people. Good, you know, a good policy idea.
Do you think Bill Shorten's going to prove to be a bit of a thorn in Albo's side going forward, or do you think he's?
I don't know. What do you reckon? I mean, he could. Potentially, he could. There's a paranoia about Bill Shorten. He's the most paranoid bloke I've ever met. They all still think Albo was somehow white-handing him. I certainly didn't think that was the case.
Well, did you see any of that?
No, apart from around Super Saturday where Albo positioned himself for the leadership in case Shorten lost, but it never came to. But I think they're paranoid about this so-called white-handing that went on. I never really saw much of it or any of it, to be honest. So
we've not seen Bill Shorten in a position like this before. Well, so
no, I mean, look.
Do you think he honestly thinks in his heart of hearts he can become leader again?
Oh, they all do, don't they?
Let's talk about Parliament coming back. We're thinking early July. The government's tax cut package will be pretty much first item on the agenda. Phil, what do you see happening here? Are we going to see the bills split so the low and middle income offset will sail through and the rest will be fought over, or do you think Labor will just tick it all off?
I reckon, this is my hunch, Labor will say we'll pass stages one and two and not three, and then the government will get the whole lot through with the crossbench in the Senate.
Right.
I think that's exactly what's going to happen.
One of the things we haven't talked about is the new Senate. The Senate.
Yes, of course. Yeah. Like,
one good thing Malcolm Turnbull did was bring in those Senate reform rules to make it harder for these minor micro parties to get three votes and do preference deals and exploit the system. And it didn't get tested last time because he had a double dissolution election, which means you only needed a small amount of votes to get in. So this is the first time it got, and it worked a treat.
Yeah.
The only two crossbenchers look like coming in are Lambie in Tasmania and Roberts in Queensland.
Yep.
And they're coming in because the people of those two states wanted them in. The government's got a really easy Senate. So these days of needing nine bloody lunatics to vote for you and all making various demands.
All makes it impossible to govern. And I think the Australian people were sick of it too. Yeah.
All right, that is all we have time for. Thank you both very much for joining us on How Good Is Politics and How Good Is Politics. It's pretty good.
Thanks, Kerrie.
Pretty good. Thank you.